together around the Lord's table once more. We gather today, whether we are gathering virtually on the radio, WBNT 1340 AM, or on Facebook or on YouTube. So again, whether you intended to join us today or this is a happy accident, we're happy to have you with us as we celebrate the Lord's Day today. And of course, naturally, and before we view other programming, whether it is NFL football later on today, or if we're streaming The Mandalorian on Disney Plus, or whatever the case might be. So, in any event, at this time, we ask Almighty God for His continued love, His mercy, and His healing. Lord Jesus, you came to gather the nations into the peace of God's kingdom. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, through common word and sacrament, you strengthen us in holiness. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, who will come in glory with salvation for your people. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
And together let us praise God's holy name with a Gloria.
Glory.
Thus says the Lord, you say, the Lord's way is not fair. Hear now, house of Israel, is it my way that is unfair? Or rather, are not your ways unfair? When someone virtuous turns away from virtue to commit iniquity and dies, it is because of the iniquity he committed that he must die. But if he turns from the wickedness he has committed and does what is right and just, he shall preserve his life, since he has turned away from all the sins that he has committed. He will surely live, he will not die. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Taste and see, taste and see the goodness of the Lord. Oh, taste and see, taste and see the goodness of the Lord. Thank you.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, if there is any encouragement in Christ, any solace in love, any participation in the Spirit, any compassion and mercy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, with the same love, united in heart, thinking one thing. Do nothing out of selfishness or out of vain glory. Rather, humbly regard others as more important than yourselves, each looking out not for his own interests, but also for those of others. Have you the same attitude that is also in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave and coming in human likeness and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Level. It makes sense. He's around 6 feet tall. I am 6 feet tall. My driver's license says 5'4". And so therefore, when I went to pull the microphone down a little bit, apparently I didn't pull it down quite to the right level. And then afterwards, the young lady who assisted as a camera operator, she said, "Yeah, Father, it looks like you were wearing an eye patch while you were preaching your homily and proclaiming the gospel." It doesn't look like an eye patch now, does it? Oh, good, no, it doesn't. Okay, I'm glad. Okay, so now that we've solved that problem. In any event, the paradox of humility, I call a paradox because when you consider Jesus' ministry here on earth 2,000 years ago, Jesus, by the rights, very well could have come down to earth as king, saying, "Not only am I the Son of God, but I was also present at the creation of the world. I am your Lord. I am your King. And so therefore, you all must serve me." But he did exactly the opposite, didn't he? Our second reading for today, taken from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians, reminds us of that. I particularly love the Philippians hymn, where it begins, "Although he was in the form of God, Jesus did not deem equality with God something to be grasped at." And so therefore, Jesus willingly came to earth, not as king, but he came as a servant, as the second reading reminds us of. He came to serve, not to be served. He came to offer himself, so that here we have the Lord Jesus, the eternally begotten Son of the Father, would come to us in, really, if you think about it, near obscurity 2,000 years ago. He would be born to a humble family, and would only spend 3 years of his time here on earth. Excuse me, 33 years, but only 3 years of that time in public ministry. Many of his own people, not all, but many of his own people rejected him, and he died a very shameful death on a cross. If that isn't humility, well, what is humility then? Because Jesus willingly chose to forsake the trappings of luxury that, by all intents and purposes, he very well could have had. And instead, he reminded us, at a time when we particularly needed to be reminded, that what really matters is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and to love your neighbor as you love yourself. Everything else can fall into place, but ultimately it goes back to loving God and loving your neighbor. Now, in thinking of the example of Jesus, we can also think of the saints who also help us to remember what is truly important, even though, according to Jesus' culture 2,000 years ago, and even our culture today, it seems like a paradox, because quite often we see, at least immediately, those who strive to have tangible signs of recognition, they are the ones who we often look to be able to emulate and to say, "That is someone who I admire," or "That is someone whom I wish to take after." Now, an example for us to consider is the great medieval saint, St. Francis of Assisi. Now, on a personal level, I have to admit that, yes, now at this point, I have a greater appreciation for the life of St. Francis. I have to admit, though, when I started my time at Siena College as an undergraduate student in the fall of 1999, and that spring of 2000, taking a course on the Franciscan tradition, I couldn't really quite appreciate what Francis was trying to accomplish. Not exactly. And there are a couple of reasons for that. One is, it seemed to me, I didn't quite understand why Francis would fast so much. Now, clearly, when I go to the doctor's office, the doctor's not telling me, "Hey, man, you really need to start having some seconds. You need to put some meat in those bones." The doctor's never told me that, and I don't think think he ever will. So, to me, the idea of intentionally starving yourself, that doesn't sound like a fun thing to do. There was that, and then also, too, there were certain things that Francis did during the course of his lifetime that, to me, may not have made a lot of sense, at least not to my 18 or 19-year-old self. Things such as, it's when Francis willingly chose to live with the poorest of the poor, he kind of went against what some of us might think of as far as what is the right thing to do. What I mean by that is, to me, it wasn't tangible, like, okay, work hard, study hard, get good grades, and then hopefully go on to be able to get a good paying job and provide for yourself, provide for others, be a good taxpaying American, things like that. That's more or less the culture I grew up in, and I think to a certain extent, there's a lot to be said for that, to pull your weight, so to speak, work hard, and to really make something of yourself. Now, looking back, I see that Francis of Assisi, what he did is not necessarily what everyone is called to do, at least not to that extent, to willingly give up everything you have and to start a religious order that embraces poverty. But during Francis's time, it was a stark symbol of, let's get back to how Jesus did. Let's become more Christ-like. Let's take a look at these different trappings, these luxuries of life, which can lead us down the wrong path, which can lead us to feeling a sense of entitlement and a sense of boasting. And instead, let us turn back to God. Let us turn back to Jesus. And so, looking at that perspective, realizing we are not all called to emulate Jesus exactly the way Francis did, but that Francis was given a special charism to do this, and instead, what we can do is, in our own way, we can emulate Jesus and emulate Francis. Consider what our Lord Jesus told Francis from the stand down on a cross. When Francis was praying, Jesus said, "Francis, rebuild my church." Francis misunderstood that at first. He did. He misunderstood that. He thought it literally meant, okay, all right. He thought it meant from a brick and mortar standpoint, you might say. Later on, he realized Jesus was asking him for real change in the church, because during the medieval period, it was a time where, unfortunately, some of the clerics were not really as Christ-like as they could have been. Putting it nicely, they were a little too cozy with the trappings of this life. And Francis's job was to say, let us bring things a little bit closer to Christ. And so therefore, it isn't a coincidence, there's the word, it isn't a coincidence that for St. Francis, that he was the one to create the first nativity. He created the first nativity, and he was able to see the child Jesus there in the crib. And so, for St. Francis, it was about returning to gospel simplicity. And St. Francis also did receive the stigmata. He saw a winged servant of the Lord, the seraph, and he did receive the stigmata, the wounds of Christ. Francis also realized, too, that not every single one of his followers would be able to follow exactly the way he did when it came to embracing poverty and fasting in particular. There was a story of one of the friars in the house where Francis lived who was having such hunger pains, and he started crying because he was so hungry. And Francis heard him, and he went to him and broke bread with him, and then he reassured him it was okay, that not everyone was called to the extreme fasting that Francis did. And from Francis, he stepped away from all the trappings he could have had, because his father was fairly both a Jew, he was a merchant, but again, Francis saw that Jesus was calling him to radical transformation, to a radical witness, to say no to a dependence upon earthly things, and earthly power, and earthly titles, and a yes to the gospel simplicity that brings us closer to Jesus, as St. Paul reminds us of in our second reading today from Philippians. So we ourselves, we may not be called to start religious orders. We may not be called, listen, all of us are called to wear Franciscan robes. We're not necessarily called to wear the habit, you might say. But what we can do is consider, are we leaving room for gospel simplicity in our lives? Or are we constantly chasing that next promotion? Are we constantly chasing that next acknowledgement? And well, certainly it is good to be acknowledged, it is good to receive praise. At the same time, if we spend our days on earth simply chasing after the next goal that can land us with a lot of applause, or chasing the next accolade, in by doing so, we kind of forget the grand prize, we forget the idea of why it's good to look for a spirit of gospel simplicity. If we do that, then we really are selling ourselves short. In Act 5:4, I know what it means to sell yourself short. I know. But moving right along, and let's now begin to land this plane, so to speak. Inspired by the example of St. Francis, whose feast day we will celebrate on October 4th, inspired by him, inspired by the saints who have come before us, as well as the humble saints who work amongst us now, those who they work very humbly at their jobs, they don't look for recognition, they're not looking for an outrageous salary in order to be able to have a very glorified and comfortable lifestyle, so to speak. Let us look to those whose priorities are centered on Jesus. We can do that. We can remind ourselves when it seems as if we are on that treadmill, so to speak, of wanting to have recognition and more recognition. Let us take a step back and realize that although Jesus himself is the eternal begotten Son of God, as St. Paul reminds us of in the second reading, although Jesus was equal to God, he willingly chose to become a servant to all of us, and he came to serve us. And so may we take heart in that, and may we prioritize what is important, the love of Jesus and the love of gospel simplicity. God bless you.
Together, let us profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial of all Father. Through him all things were made, for us to men for our salvation, and he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate the Virgin Mary, and became man. For us today he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again
in glory to judge the living and dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one Holy Spirit and apostolic church. I confess from baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead.
healing and hope, we sing to the Lord.
Hear us, Savior, hear our prayer. Hear us, Savior, hear our prayer.
For those requests that have been included in our Book of Intentions, we sing to the Lord.
Hear us, Savior, hear our prayer. Hear us, Savior, hear our prayer.
For those in need among us, especially the sick, the dying, and those who have died, we sing to the Lord.
Hear us, Savior, hear our prayer. Hear us, Savior, hear our prayer.
We especially pray for the repose of the soul of Frances San Marco, who was able to be brought to her final resting place earlier today in this escaping day. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Hear our Savior, hear our prayer. Hear our Savior, hear our prayer.
We pray these prayers to Jesus Christ, our risen Lord.
Please join us in singing our offertory song, Turn to Me.
Lord, for all and all.
acceptable to God and my Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
Grant us, the merciful God, that this our offering may find acceptance with you, and that through it the wellspring of all blessing may be laid open before us through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For through his paschal mystery, he accomplished the marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, summoning us to the glory of being now called the chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people of your own possession, to proclaim everywhere your mighty works. For you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. And so with angels and archangels, the thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, and to that end we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna.
Throughout the ages, only merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and I pray
deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope of the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, power, glory, and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, who graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Let us pray. May this heavenly mystery, O Lord, restore us in mind and body, that we may be co-heirs in glory with Christ, to whose suffering we are united whenever we proclaim his death, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Again, thank you to all of you who are joining us today. Certainly wish all of you a very blessed rest of the day today. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our defense against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And to the Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan, and now the evil spirits, who prowl about the world, seeking to ruin our souls. Amen.
This is pretty bad. This is, even by my standards, this is pretty bad. What kind of books do skunks read? What kind of books do skunks read? Best smellers.